we have a very learned person who is going to talk on this specific aspect. For the introduction purpose, I have great pleasure in, you know, making some of the important aspects before the audience. As you all know that this Indian economy, especially Indian banking and insurance sector, is really strong enough, and it is not having any contagious effects of the US financial crisis. We are facing two crises. One crisis for the past about a year, 1.5 years or so, external international crisis from Western to the Asian countries. And we are facing internal crisis, the crisis of Satyam. That is a success story as well as an unsuccess story. So with these two crisis situations in India, there is a lot of discussion on the confidence level of the investors, especially in different areas. The areas may be stock market, recession taking place, in the area of real estate, which is now having a recession or stability, specifically because for the past couple of years, there has been a lot of overvaluation in that real estate area, infrastructure development and all. But because of the two crises, internal and external, the regulations, we are thankful to the regulators, we are thankful to the government, we are thankful to the bodies concerned that we do not have any direct impact on the banking sector, but there are some indirect effects which our distinguished speaker is going to tell about how these are the important things due to collateralized obligations, due to entities, of the exposure of our out of the total almost how much, sir? 70 crores of the debt waiver scheme. Then other schemes with regard to NRE, with regard to FCNR, with regard to other schemes of NREGA, and all other schemes, including the financial inclusion, which has taken up. So in a situation where political pressure on the banking sector is too much to go to the rural sector, to go to the microcredit, to go to the microfinance areas, and invest into the areas where there are no better revenues can be generated, no income generation can be expected. It means that there is more weightage of risk. Risk is high. So the exposure of banks are already having so much of a risk exposure. So in this situation, these are the international and Indian crisis has really had some spillover effects. The effect on the rise in the price of risk, because as the risk increases, the weightage of risk undergo a change, maybe 75 to 100, 150 points, then coming down, this weightage of risk undergo a change. Then reduction in the issuance of international bonds, a lot of impact has taken place in this. Then again on Forex, foreign exchange reserves, then again on SEZ, then again on the credit market, and all other sectors which are indirectly affected. So the emphasis particularly on this particular session is to see how trends of the banking sector are in the right direction, or what corrections have been made by the Reserve Bank of India and with the help of the government of India, measures that is taken. Because you know that volatility is very fast in banking sector also. So always there is need of pricing of the issues. You know, there are a number of credit rating agencies, and these credit rating agencies have also been concentrating on pricing the issues. So now there is a lot of dilemma in this regard. So with these few opening remarks, I invite Mr. Matthew for his presentation. Thank you very much.
Just because US or some part of the world has a cold, it doesn't mean that in India we have pneumonia. The days of yonder are over when, if you recall what happened in Thailand in the financial market, the entire financial market of Thailand was funded by the US market in the share issues, and one fine moment they withdrew, and that was a major crisis at that time. That would never ever occur in India for the simple reason our regulator is an overactive regulator. Systems are in place. Maybe we have got it from the British, but we are very prudent in our operations. No crisis which took place in Thailand or any of the East affected us. Neither the crisis that took place in the West has affected us. Dr. Reddy, the previous chairman, previous governor of Reserve Bank of India, specifically said, what crisis? I don't see a crisis in India. When asked to comment about the global crisis. But there are spillovers. I'm not saying it is not. There are spillovers. For example, the last 10 years or 20, 15 years, colleges and universities in this country produced only IT graduates or IT aspirants. Pure sciences went for a toss. Banking had lost its relevance. Everybody wanted to be an IT graduate. Why? Because an IT sector paid well. Why did IT sector pay well? Because you are doing an electronic coolies job for the West. The job that he doesn't want to do, the job that he is not comfortable doing, he passes it on to fellows who are willing to do at a price which is much higher than the price available locally. When the Britisher came, he started plantations in Singapore, Malaysia, Sri Lanka, and he exported Indians in those places because coolies were cheaper. That may be 200 years ago, but today we are doing exactly the same electronic coolie. When a doctor dictates his prescription to the patient, he doesn't want to have a litigation. The coolie in India writes down what he said earlier. And we call a glorified term medical transcription. So when they have a problem, the coolie also had a problem. The major impact that has been created here is in the IT sector because it had a direct linkage with the US market. What happened when IT sector had an impact? Salaries went for a toss. When the projects were ending, those boys who worked for 10 years in the project knew they were getting pink slips before they got the red slip. They are the ones who have booked the L&T flats and found that they can't pay the premium or the EMI next month. So there is a change starting. There is a change starting. I'm not saying it is not, but not in the financial sector. The reality is one sector which got affected. What happened in the subprime crisis in US? The subprime crisis was you let go money the way you wanted without any prudential norms. Houses were given if you wanted. Whether your ability to pay back your installments was not a criteria. Valuations were different. Parameters were not taken into account. And so what happened? When you give up and say, I cannot pay, somebody takes the houses. In fact, as a banker here, what we do? We finance, say, auto rickshaws or cars. You will go and find a banker can do what? He will confiscate the car. Ek car hai, do car hai, teen car hai, das car hai. Uske baad kya karega? He has to pay rent for maintaining, keeping the car there. And you have to appoint a guard to watch the car. So good money after bad money. So this is a sequence of things that would have taken place. The major sector in India that would have been really involved is the IT sector. Spillover of IT sector went into the reality sector. In fact, I do not know your neighbor, MR Properties, next to the golf court. He had announced a project called Boulevard or something, I don't remember. At 8,000 rupees square feet per square feet, 8,000 per square feet. The same property is today available at 4,000 rupees per square feet. If a banker had to lend at 8,000 per square feet, what is the collateral he is holding today? It has no relevance. Today you will sit at home and you will get SMS, 3 lakhs open plot available at Shamshabad. What happened to Shamshabad, which was beyond the common man's reach? Have you heard the new term in banking called affordable housing? That means you accept that housing was not affordable earlier. These L&T flats were booked as low as 30 lakhs for a 3-bedroom. Today the same L&T flats have gone for 85 lakhs. Who created the vacuum? The ballooning effect. That came from the Western service industry, maybe what we call the IT industry. Reserve Bank of India, coming to banking, there has been slowdown in the various sector because of money not being available. Government has taken or put in place certain systems and procedures. One, they have increased the liquidity availability in the market. Today, funding is not an issue, provided you have a project and a worthwhile bankable project. They have brought down the cost of funds. I think about a year and a half ago, you would have got an average interest rate of on a deposit up to 11 or 11.5, even 12. Today, it's come down to 9 rupees, 9%. You had to borrow, you had to pay up to 12% for a housing. Today, State Bank of India has announced 8% for 1 year. And it may go to 8.5, 8.75 or 9, second year, third year, depending on the market conditions. So what has happened is, they have brought down funding availability and higher liquidity. Second, major industrial sector is SME sector. SME sector has been given a thrust. The Reserve Bank of India have a special focus program on SME funding. Government of India has tuned their policies to increase funding to SFCs. Maintaining the credit flow and reforming the financial sector. Actually, some of you students would have noticed, 2009 March was the doomsday on 31st of March, when the entire financial sector was to be opened up to the US economy. That means Citibank, Goldman Sachs, or anybody can come in and put their flag anywhere they want in the Indian country without having anything to do with the government regulations. The sector being opened was opposed by a section of the politics in this country. But today, the question of their coming here doesn't arise because they may not be existing there itself. 17 national banks in US have been taken over by the government of US or have been funded. So when their prime existence becomes a problem, the question of going to the neighboring country doesn't arise. And therefore, we are comfortable. There is a possibility of having a problem in certain areas in India. I'm not saying it is not so. For example, credit cards. The delinquency rates in credit cards are on the increase. But who started this? All multinational banks. If I have known your name or your grandfather's name, I'll send you a card. Then you ask why I didn't want the card, you take back the card, by then your first bill will come. They went into a mass card process in this country. Maybe the economy has boomed because card booming was there, but default rates have also gone. So much so, today Citibank has gone into a very tight shell. Standard Chartered has gone into a white shell. And therefore, they are finding it difficult to do the exercises. Third point, there is an effective implementation of Basel II norms in India. We are far, far ahead compared to the rest of the world. What is the basis of my saying? The last review at Basel II conference said India was ready for Basel II. When I say India is ready for Basel II, I mean to say the public sector banks in this country. After having said what I said, to sum up so far, only one point. India is an island of stability in the turmoil of the world. We have nothing to worry. While you would have seen the cat drinking the milk, it closes its eyes and licks, and they believe that nobody else has seen that. I am not closing my eyes to the world-wide phenomena that is happening, even if it doesn't have an impact on the Indian economy. But at the same time, I would be prudent to take measures to see that my country's financial system is strengthened further. Our risk is reduced by spreading our network. Today, the poorest of poor in India can have accessibility to a banking system. In fact, one of the best words we have used in our banking dictionary is financial inclusion. If you come from a village or a nearby town, 10 years ago, you wouldn't find a single lady in that branch. Today, you will find good groups of self-help women doing banking, drawing money, having entrepreneurial ability, returning the money. 99% recovery has been there in only one group, and that is a self-help group. And that is a phenomenon which we have borrowed from our neighbor, Bangladesh. What are the remedies therefore available? I have listed out about 11 points just for thought. Maybe all of them will not work, or some of them may work. There is every possibility that repo rate would be reduced further, basically to increase what is called liquidity crunch. Right now, I don't believe there is major liquidity crunch because the government has been continuously monitoring. Two, reducing lendable rate of interest. In the last 6 months, twice the rate of interest has been reduced. Three, provisions for funding mutual funds and non-banking financial institutions. At one time, they were no-nos for banking. Today, government says you can fund them because funding them will increase turnover and therefore a layman may not be affected. There's a possibility that today you have a feeling of comfort level when you say that your bank deposit in the government bank is guaranteed. Your bank deposit may not go anywhere. In fact, when subprime crisis in US took place or the global financial meltdown took place in India, one bank got an image of being affected. Which bank was that? I see. That is why now they advertise 50 saal se rishta mein rakhe hue. Relationship for the last 50 years. Relationship with customers, relationship with bank, relationship with you and me. I think that's a campaign that is now running on TVs and hoardings and all that. Why did it run away? Why was there a run in the market? Because people's comfort level was not there. They presumed that ICICI was exposed to the same meltdown. And who was the beneficiary? The chairman of State Bank went on record to say that State Bank of India branches are receiving 1 crore a day into their bank deposits. And every nationalized bank received an equivalent amount. That means people have trust and confidence in a government-oriented lending. Therefore, my suggestion would be, even though there is a deposit guarantee scheme, in order to enhance the comfort level of a layman, the government can enhance the deposit guaranteed period either by, say, 2-year IGASTAN guarantee, a sovereign guarantee, or increase the value of the amount. Today, you may put 10 lakhs. The deposit guarantee will take care of only 1 lakh. So both in terms of value and period, the government could examine in order to reassure the public at large. There should be an amount of foreign exchange management in order to reduce volatility in the foreign exchange market. In fact, I have one of the clients in Hyderabad who is an exporter. He had taken certain forward measures, covers. And today that fellow is weeping. Every month he pays up about 85 lakhs to cover up his commitments made. So this volatility in the exchange should be taken care of. Permitting FDI participation at higher level so that competition can be put in place. We have substantial amount of foreign exchange in this country today. In fact, I do not know whether you remember or not, definitely before you entered the portals of this college, we were so bad at one time, we had to mortgage the gold of this country to run the foreign exchange of this country. It was during P.V. Narasimha Rao's period that we have done. Today, our foreign exchange comfort level is very, very high. Use that to maintain your foreign exchange management and volatility in the market. Remove the cap on NRE deposits, NRE, NRO, whatever it is, enabling the Indian persons of Indian origin who stay abroad to pump in more money into our system. I mentioned about SME funding. SME also, government can establish a substantial corpus to give funding at a reduced rate. So you see, what happens is, you must understand, an SME fellow is one man, many men in one man. He has to be an entrepreneur. He has to be his own finance manager. He has to be his own marketing manager. He has to be his own HR man. If you are studying MBA here, you think each of them there is a man. There is no such man in an SME. He is all in one man. And an expert metallurgist may not know how to market. So the risk level he takes is far more higher. Therefore, the system must give a support to him and ensure that his existence is assured. Two major areas of attractive government intervention has taken place in the recent past. One is our National Highway Authority. The highways have come, lot of work has gone. Infrastructure projects have been put to place and they have done. In fact, our ring roads, our flyover to Gachibowli, the National Triangular Highway project, all has given enormous amount of work, finances, and a boost to the economy. Therefore, the government and Reserve Bank of India must put a fast track on these projects. And finally, there should be open channel of communication of all the initiatives taken by the Reserve Bank of India and the government to be brought forward to the public. To sum up what I have said is, one, there is no crisis in India. Two, we are an island of stability. Three, we have a strong regulated economy which has withstood the test of time. Four, we can put in place to better the system by putting into place a series of suggested measures. I had suggested about 11 measures, all of them relating to the economy and banking. Finally, let me assure you one thing. Nothing will happen to the Indian banking system as it stands today. Even if you have no money, it will allow you to borrow. Even if you have money, it will allow you to deposit and it will be safe. Thank you very much.